190 billion, 700 billion, or even 7 trillion, what if governments just stopped subsidising fossil fuels? In this video, I will explain the different types of fossil fuel subsidies, why we can get very different numbers, why fossil fuel subsidies just suck, and looking at renewable subsidies. The UN and IEA's definition of energy subsidies is any measure that keeps prices for consumers below market levels, or for producers above market levels, or that reduces costs for consumers and producers. So, we can classify fossil fuel subsidies into two categories, production subsidies and consumption subsidies. Production subsidies are direct government payments or tax breaks that contribute towards reducing the cost of producing fossil fuel. In other words, making it cheaper for companies to produce the fossil fuels. Consumption subsidies are when the government funds the difference between what consumers pay and what the actual or market rate is. Whilst we tend to think of subsidies as cash grants, they can take many different forms, such as tax cuts, subsidized credit, and guarantees. However, definitions of what subsidies actually take into account can vary, which is one of the reasons why we see subsidy numbers being quite different. Some definitions make distinctions between explicit and implicit subsidies, such as the IMF. Explicit ones are the subsidies we just spoke about. Implicit subsidies are missing taxes and external costs or externalities, such as air pollution caused by fossil fuels, climate change, and road traffic. According to Sovacool and Koplow, there are three ways fossil fuel subsidies are calculated. The inventory approach, mostly used by the OECD, the price gap approach, used by the IEA, and a combination of the two approaches. Firstly, the inventory approach looks at specific programs and essentially makes a catalogue of them to then aggregate the numbers. The price gap approach compares average end-user prices paid by consumers with reference prices that correspond to the full cost of supply. So, it only looks at consumer subsidies. Reference prices, which can sometimes be hard to calculate, are normally based on international market prices. Since subsidies that don't affect the price aren't reflected, price gaps should be seen as lower bound estimates. So how much are we subsidising fossil fuels? Here you can see consumption subsidies calculated by the IEA with the price gap approach. It fluctuates between 250 billion a year to 1 trillion. This graph here uses the OECD-IEA combination approach, adding producer subsidies too, for 51 countries. In 2021, for example, 190 billion were producer subsidies and 500 billion were consumption subsidies, according to this data, which is quite similar to what the previous graph showed. Other calculations show higher results, such as this one by IISD. Here, certain countries have higher subsidies as it takes into account subsidies for state-owned firms. Now, what about that 7 trillion number we sometimes see? So that's from the IMF, which also incorporates externalities such as climate change damages, health issues from pollution, and road traffic problems. Here you can see both explicit and implicit subsidies. The explicit ones are the same ones as the ones earlier, so around 500 billion. But if we add the implicit ones, then suddenly the number skyrockets to more than 7 trillion a year. In total, around 30% comes from climate change, another 30% from local air pollution, 18% are direct subsidies, and then 17% from road externalities such as congestion and accidents. To be honest, adding road externalities as fossil fuel subsidies can definitely be debated if we are comparing them to electric cars instead of public transport. Therefore, we can see that fossil fuel subsidies aren't really going down. Although G20 countries made some comments on reducing subsidies many years ago, we can see that it's not really effective, with some governments plainly lying. In the UK, for example, a representative of the Treasury said that the UK does not give subsidies to fossil fuels. If we just do a quick search into the OECD's database, then... what's that? IISD, which also took its data from the OECD database, show here that the UK gave $2 billion in direct transfers and $12 billion in tax expenditure between 2017 and 2019. There is also an interesting point to be made about the future government spending for fossil fuel decommissioning. In this video, I was joined by Dr. Krista Halttunen, a sustainability researcher at Imperial College London.
And then also if there's subsidies or tax breaks that relate to decommissioning, like in the UK, the cost of decommissioning our oil and gas facilities is going to be very high. And the Treasury has promised to foot at least 30% of that bill.
Right. So what about renewable subsidies? Here you have a direct comparison for 2017 between fossil fuel subsidies and clean energy subsidies. In terms of countries, this is what it looks like. The IEA also has some numbers for what they call clean energy support from governments such as renewables, electrification, and efficiency measures. They annoyingly have made these graphs hard to quickly understand, so I've made it a bit more understandable. But basically, between April 2021 and April 2022, it was 334 billion, and then between April 2022 and April 2023, it was 614 billion. What specific support goes into the numbers can be seen here. Just a small reminder that these numbers here are between 2020 and 2023, not yearly. There, that. By the way, that's really not enough at all, but that's a topic for another video. For clean cooking, if you dig a little deeper into the policies, these actually subsidise fossil fuels such as gas for cooking. However, it does tend to be better than what's currently used, such as wood in certain developing countries, and reduces health issues too. So to be honest, that's not a major issue and is fine. What isn't fine are some of the policies you can find in here. If you dig a little deeper into the numbers and policies, you can find stuff like Australia's long-term emissions reduction plan, which does include support for liquefied natural gas. Another small side note is that if you look at the policies on this website, you seem to see more policies from the EU and the US, with the Inflation Reduction Act, for example. But let's not forget about overall investment and not just subsidies in clean energy, because that can show a different picture. Finally, be careful with dumbass articles like this one from the World Economic Forum. They included support for energy affordability into their clean energy support numbers. But most of that funding was to keep natural gas cheaper, in other words, a fossil fuel subsidy, not a clean energy one. Regardless of the obvious issues with subsidising fossil fuels, just the action of subsidising them can cause other problems too. Some say that through making prices artificially cheaper, it decreases the motivation for energy efficiency and decreasing energy demand. There is also much evidence that fossil fuel subsidies are regressive and benefit the rich more. Another issue with these subsidies, particularly producer ones, is that they are self-replicating, as they can lock in the energy landscape and infrastructure of a country.
A lot of these subsidies might really encourage the building of new fossil fuel projects. And this is quite important, for example, in the United States, where there's still quite a lot of new oil production being ramped up, especially in the shale area. So having tax breaks that affect that part of the life cycle can then lead to carbon lock-in further down the line, so you're more likely to ramp up new projects because of subsidies.
A study by the World Bank shows that during the year 2004, which saw high oil prices, many developing countries increased their subsidies to counter this spike. However, once oil prices went back to normal prices, the subsidies still remained, implying that it's easier to implement them than to remove them. However, certain subsidies in certain contexts and countries have definitely been positive socially, protecting customers from high prices, which you can read in Sovacool's paper. So what things can be done? Well, one of the ways to go is with a subsidy swap. This is, for example, swapping a subsidy for coal with a subsidy for a cleaner energy. Many countries have used this to increase subsidies in different sectors such as infrastructure development. However, there are many cases of countries going back to old subsidies they tried to remove. Why is that? Well, sometimes reforms are cancelled because oil prices suddenly rise to high levels, which then, in a way, forces governments to reinstate the subsidy. Other times, it's because suddenly removing subsidies can create a massive economic shock, which is obviously unpopular and leads to social unrest and revolts like in Ecuador in 2019. This paper explains a similar phenomenon. Basically, countries that hold the price of oil low through subsidies for months and months and years can then receive massive backlash when they eventually have to remove the subsidy as the price just skyrockets. Therefore, a set of mechanisms to compensate people, most importantly poorer households, is essential. If you want to learn more about how full fossil fuel subsidy price reforms could actually solve a few SDGs, then I invite you to read this IMF page and make your own judgment. However, investment into alternatives needs to be there, or else you can run into the problems that we previously stated.
There's not always great direct substitutes, so it's not just enough that we just turn off the funding for fossil fuels. We also need to build the infrastructure for the future energy system.
Just Have a Think has also done a very good video on this topic if you want to learn a bit more. Thank you so much for watching. If you like this video and want to learn more about climate change and energy, don't forget to subscribe.